Well, it's time of Advent, and many children at the moment are praying, and I was reading various prayers by children. I know I've read some out in the past. Here's a few more. Dear God, I went to this wedding and they were kissing right there in church. Is that okay? Dear God, thank you for the baby brother, but what I prayed for was a puppy. Dear God, my grandpa says you were around when he was a little boy. How far back do you go? Dear God, did you mean for giraffes to look like that, or was it an accident? Dear God, maybe Cain and Abel would not kill each other so much if they each had their own rooms. It works out okay with me and my brother. Yes, this is the time of Advent, the time of waiting, but many people seem to think it's about waiting for Christmas and Christmas Day, and that's how our commercial world is based. But it's not actually, from a spiritual point of view, about waiting for Christmas at all. It's not about waiting for the incarnation. Spiritually and theologically, it's always been about waiting for the return of Christ in the future. Now, I know that that's a belief that we don't always immediately relate to, because it seems so difficult and sort of detached from us in some ways, or at least it's not something we think about very often. But I want to argue that having an Advent spirituality is key not only to our mental and physical well-being, but our spiritual well-being. Having an Advent perspective is, in fact, probably more important than even having a Christmas perspective in many ways, and I hope I'll try and explain what I mean by that by the end of this sermon. The Bible is full of waiting. We remember how Abraham and Sarah waited for a long time. They didn't actually realize, of course, they were going to be called to travel and start the new people that they were called to start, the people of Israel. But they waited for a long time before they were called. When you think of people like Joseph, he waited a long time in prison before he became Pharaoh's number two. The people of Israel across the desert waited for 40 years before they were eventually allowed into the promised land. And God seems to wait time after time through the prophets and the kings for the right king who will lead the kingdom in a just way. So many let him down. And then there's the period of exile, which this passage in Isaiah refers to. Just for those of you who may not know the history of the people of Israel, here it is in a very quick way. The Jewish monarchy was established in 1020, approximately, with Saul, the first king. And then Jerusalem was made David's kingdom in about the year 1000 AD. The first temple then was built in the time of Solomon, about 960. Did I say AD? I meant BC, excuse me. 1000 BC. Then in 960, the first temple was built under King Solomon. And then 930, under Solomon's legacy, the kingdom that was based in Jerusalem split into two halves, with Israel in the north and Judah in the south. And then in 720 BC, Israel was crushed by the Assyrians, and 10 of the Jewish tribes were exiled, now known as the 10 Lost Tribes. And then in 586 BC, the remaining part of the kingdom, Judah, where Jerusalem was conquered by the Babylonians, and the Jewish people were put into exile in Babylon. And many of the prophetic writings are written about this period in Jewish history. Eventually, in fact, it wasn't that much longer, in about 538 to 512 BC, during the Persian and Hellenistic periods, the Jewish people came back from Babylon to Jerusalem, and permission under, you remember during the time when Nehemiah was working on behalf of the Jewish people to get the temple rebuilt, and Ezra, during this period, the temple was rebuilt. But the time of exile, from 586 to about 540 BC, was an incredibly painful one for the Jewish people. Having lost their northern kingdom 200 years before, to then lose the very temple and to lose their home place and to be exiled was really, really difficult. And so when you read the prophets like Isaiah, you see many passages which talk about this pain. In Isaiah 63, for example, the chapter before the one we heard, we read the prophet said, "Your holy people took possession for a little while, but now our adversaries have trampled down your sanctuary. We have long been like those whom you do not rule, like those not called by your name. Our adversaries have trampled down your sanctuary." Later on in Isaiah 64, we read, "Zion has become a wilderness, Jerusalem a desolation. Our holy and beautiful house where our ancestors praised you has been burned with fire." You can hear the pain, can't you, in those passages. And then in this early part of 64, from what was read this morning, we hear this cry from the prophet, "Oh, that you would open the heavens and come down." And then at the end of that passage, "Do not be exceedingly angry, O Lord, and do not remember our iniquity forever. We are all your people. Come, Lord, and rescue us." Now, even though this passage may have been written after the return from exile, according to some theologians, you can hear the pain of a people in exile. There is this passage of hope in the middle, where it says, "For ages past, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you who work for those who wait him." But apart from that moment of hope, that emphasis on waiting, the emphasis is on exile. In the New Testament, however, exile is seen in a different light. There is no emphasis on us needing to return to Jerusalem. In fact, the actual physicality of language and the geopolitical nature of language that you find in the Old Testament is missing. Instead, exile is about being exiled from the kingdom of God. According to the New Testament perspective, our life at the moment is one where we experience, yes, happy times some of the time. Yesterday we had a lovely wedding. You might have had a lovely piece of cake at the new cake shop that's just opened around the corner just the other day. I certainly have. You might have had some good experiences, and there may be lots to look forward to. But actually, there's also lots of cracks in the pavement. There's lots of issues that we struggle with. And from a New Testament perspective, exile is being exiled from the life that God will eventually bring in by his kingdom. It is the life that will eventually be inaugurated at the second arrival of Christ on earth. Now, as I say, I know that people find that hard to relate with sometimes. But actually, I think, and this is, I hope God give me grace to explain this, I think this is a default part of our Christian spirituality. What do I mean by saying it's a default part of our Christian spirituality? Well, just remember the thief on the cross, when Jesus was on the cross. The thief said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." The thief seemed to know that no matter how much suffering Jesus was going through and how much pain he was going through with carrying the sin of the world and people all around him laughing at him, the thief knew that this world wasn't the only world, that there would be a world ahead that would be free of suffering and pain, a world where joy, love, peace, and justice would reign. And spiritually, although the thief didn't understand any of kingdom theology, he intuitively knew that there was something coming. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, when he was arrested, was in prison for a long time. But just before he was decapitated, he said, in similar words to this, "The best is yet to be. The best is yet to be." He didn't fear his death because he had experienced the kingdom breaking through into his life. At its best, when we share the peace and celebrate the Eucharist and enjoy wonderful events like the Christmas fair or the summer fair or other events like that, and when we gather around the Eucharist, we here at this church are experiencing spiritually something of what I'm trying to talk about. When I say it's a default spirituality, I mean it's something that theologically and academically we may struggle with, some of us, but that spiritually we experience as the kingdom breaks through. And yes, I do believe in the return of Christ to this world. I do believe in the kingdom that is to come. But what I'm saying is that we experience that kingdom by faith now. We experience that belief that evil will not triumph in the end, that we will have an eternity of peace and love with God, that even death itself will not get in our way. That is the Christian hope. The Christian hope of eventual triumph of good over evil that is lived out spiritually in the here and now. And so, for the Christian, life isn't just what is in front of us. I've bought this Alexa machine. I'm sure you've seen them advertised. I'm getting very used to sort of asking Alexa what the weather is and, you know, what the news is and all sorts. But you ask it a religious question, and it will always give you the same answer. People have different views of religion, period. It won't go any further than that. That's because that's the stock 21st century answer. By the way, if you're wondering what Alexa is, it's a little machine that can listen to your voice and can play you music. And I think Alexa sums up the spirit of the age. Oh, an age which is focused on the here and now, on consumerism, on commercialism, on living in the present moment. What music are you listening to? What TV program are you watching? But the Advent hope is different. The Advent hope is that even if the television's not working, or the computer's not working, or the job is going badly, or I've broken my leg, I can still sit with God and experience his presence, however tentatively and however imperfectly, by his Spirit, and pray to him and experience something of this future kingdom breaking through to my life. That's what the Advent hope is. It's about spirituality. It's about growing in this inner sense of peace and joy through our prayer lives, through our fellowship. And that's why whatever happens to us can sometimes only strengthen our Advent spirituality. I know you may have got tired of me saying this, but I remember very well when I broke my rib and I had to sleep in a chair for 10 days and 10 nights. It was actually a painful time of recovery, but it was also a time of growing spirituality, as I had to stop working as hard and I had to pray longer. It was a time where the Advent kingdom broke through into my life in a new way. So Advent is about the future kingdom spiritually breaking through to us. It's about being filled with that inner peace and joy and sense of the victory of life over death, of good over evil, of Christ's forgiveness over a world lacking in forgiveness. May I just conclude by saying, on a practical level, why this Advent spirituality is so important, and I would say foundational to our Christian life. Well, I've already explained that it frees us from the commercial superficiality of our world, which lives in the present moment. Instead of simply being people who are entertained and who live for entertainment or for hedonism or materialism, we are people who grow in our spirituality. And there's a growing interest in that in our society. Secondly, and really importantly, if we grow in an Advent spirituality, we're able to cope when, for example, a loved one is diagnosed with an illness which is serious, or we see someone suffering. Because if we're filled with an Advent spirituality, we know that this world is not the only world, that our loved one who may be dying is going to be with God. And that inner confidence transcends and changes our perspective on that suffering. Thirdly, having an Advent spirituality hopefully makes us view church differently too. Here we are, gathered together, and it's lovely to have the fellowship. But we're also in a world full of suffering and pain, and that will enter the church too. We need to be a church where people can share can open up, can confide in each other. Vivian over here is just about to be a pastoral assistant and will be part of that process of being a listener, as there are other pastoral assistants here. But you're all good at pastoral work. We should be a church which is experiencing the vulnerability of this broken world, but also the future hope that is ours in Christ. And finally, on a completely personal level, whatever issues we may be struggling with personally, take heart. They could be being used to strengthen your Advent spirituality. They could be being used to mold you closer to the person of Christ. May God grant us an Advent spirituality. In his name, amen. Perhaps we could just have a moment's silence just to reflect on that before Julia introduces the creed.